Good afternoon. I'm Graham Oakes. I'm the chairman of the Digital Watermarking Alliance, and thank you very much for coming. We have digital watermarking cups for everybody, so they will all be available for everybody at the end. I'd like to introduce you to Eric Hebrick, who's from Odetto, one of our premier members, who will be making the presentation. Thanks very much.
Okay. Hi, everyone. So Odetto is one of the members of the Odetto of the Watermarking Alliance. So we are an organization that promotes the use of watermarking and explains how things can work in your environment. Odetto is a company that has been working for many years in the content security area. Since 2011, we have been doing watermarking as a means to help customers protect their content further. We are a member of the DWA, but there's also a lot of other industry forums that are currently focusing on watermarking, and we're contributing to most of them. So Streaming Video Alliance, Dutch Industry Forum, and the Ultra HD Forum. So to start off, watermarking. I got a question a lot this exhibition. So watermarking is actually changing the video or audio content that you're distributing. And we're putting in a payload that when content leaks, we can extract that payload and we can use the information that we get from that. So we're actually changing the content. To begin off, this is actually a very interesting slide because this shows a few different things. What you're looking at is the actual torrent usage, BitTorrent usage of a major US movie title of the last year. And this graph can uniquely show what watermarking can bring you, what kind of extra insights you can have. So the colors, maybe you can't read them, the colors, green camcordings, light blue, first distributor, the red is the DVD, the color next, the magenta is the second distributor, and the last one are the Blu-rays. What's unique here is that normally when you try to make such measurements, you will often have to identify content based on what is actually described in the file name. This is a DVD rip, or this is a Blu-ray rip, etc. What watermarking can bring here, and what it will show you as extra insight, is that you can uniquely identify this is actually not a DVD rip or not a Blu-ray rip. This is actually coming from distributor X that is using their OTT platform to offer this content. So this kind of insight will help operators and content owners see exactly what is coming from where and without any false noise created by pirates, etc. The other benefit of having such kind of information is that you can really drill down in what is the effect on certain geographic areas so that you can then work with certain operators to change windowing, to negotiate different prices because they may not be doing enough to combat piracy, or they will be doing a lot of anti-piracy. That will be made visible by these kind of information. For instance, if we start looking at one region where the first distributor leak came from, which in this case is South Korea, so this is the worldwide graph. If we start looking at the South Korean graph, so just looking at the piracy that came from that region, you'll see a huge difference, and you see the impact that the availability of a high-quality first rip had on the overall piracy in that region. It will resemble the effect on Blu-ray sales later on in that region, because you see now only there's a lift of 2% of the piracy, and that is also directly related to the actual sales that will happen later in that region. So this is the level of insight that watermarking can provide in combination with other means of piracy monitoring. Okay. Oh, excuse me. One click too many. So these are some statistics to show you how large the problem really is. So we're talking about 50% of the internet is estimated to be pirated content. That's a huge number. And that includes some of the YouTube traffic, because there's a lot of pirated content on YouTube, for instance. So that should not be underestimated. I think everyone has heard about Kodi. So that's actually a platform that gives you easy access to content, and you can load plugins on it that will give you access to illegal content. And 9% of 8.8% of the US households is actually using Kodi, and roughly 2/3 of that is actively using that to get access to illegal content. Okay. So torrents, Kodi, there's many ways where you can consume illegal content. And you should not only think of movies, you should also think of live content. Because there's now, with the movie labs, enhanced copy protection requirements, ultra HD content must be protected with session-based watermarking. And I'll get to that later. So there are strict stipulations in order to distribute and offer that high-quality content to your consumers. Torrents, Pirate Bay still receives this summer, last measurement that we have is they get around 280 million visitors to the site. So that's a huge amount. So it's still extremely popular. We're seeing VPNs in heavy use to hide IP addresses, etc. For the Kodi boxes, we're looking at roughly 40 million active users. Social network, live streams. We're seeing Facebook Live, YouTube. There's a lot of growth in that area that we see. Web-based redistribution. So you should not only think of the standard advertisement support, the streaming sites. You think of the Modbro apps on your phone. We see in upcoming areas like developing areas like India, the majority is coming from mobile application piracy. We see pirate set-top boxes. So those are devices that are even produced specifically for pirate groups that have everything included as a total end-to-end solution. And of course, we see other forms of piracy, and that could be things like password sharing. That's quite popular. Some of the subscriptions offer multiple views at the same time, so you see a lot of people sharing their passwords, but there's also credential theft. Yeah? And you can go on online, on the internet, on the black markets, and you can just buy lots of OTT credentials that have been stolen. And often, in combination with the previous, the piracy there remains unnoticed, because it is often allowed to have multiple concurrent streams viewable from totally different regions in the world. So what can watermarking do there? So there's two levels of watermarking that I'd like to make clear. So there's the distributor level watermarking that is primarily targeted content owners. Content owners will be able to use this level of watermarking to identify where their content leaked from. So if they distribute their content, if you are a large movie studio, you distribute your content to Comcast, Netflix, Apple, you name it, and something leaks online. So your first identification will be, like you saw on the first graph, which of those operators did the content leak from. And distributor level watermarking is helping you to do that. The second step is consumer level watermarking. So once you've identified where it came from, you can approach that operator and negotiate with him how to deal with identifying piracy on his platform. If he has a consumer-level watermarking solution in place, you can immediately drill down to the individual subscriber identity that actually leaked the content. So, like I said, this is a stipulation for distribution of Ultra HD content in the consumer market. So we see a lot of operators coming to Irdeto, but also to the watermarking companies in general, to find out what does the solution look like in their network. There are basically two technical solutions that are used in the industry. One is one-step watermarking. So one-step watermarking means typically that you do at the client side, so at the device that is in the end user's possession. You do watermarking that's usually integrated with the hardware, because that's basically the only way to do it securely. And It is a solution that works very well, but has some limitations. One of the limitations is that it's usually only used in controlled markets, like broadcast, set-top box-based environments, or where the operator has full control over the entire set-top box population base or device base. Where that's not the case, typically pirates, they will always go for the weakest link. So the second solution, and that is very important when we're talking about OTT streaming, we're not always having a managed device base. So there's lots of unmanaged devices out there. Take your average Android phone, your Android devices, your iPhones, etc. There's no specific hardware in there that anchors the security. And that is the crucial part why a two-step watermarking will be a solution in that market. Two-step watermarking is actually something that resides entirely on the network side and does not involve the client at all. The philosophy there is when the signal arrives at the device, at the client, it's already uniquely watermarked. Yeah? It's called two-step because watermarking is actually quite a heavy process. Yeah? You have to basically analyze the video and you have to process all the pixels and you have to put something in there. And that's a heavy thing. So if you have to do it at scale on the network side to millions of users, millions of clients, that doesn't scale. So the two-step watermarking usually starts off by creating a set of variants of the watermark, let's say an A and a B variant. And then at the moment of delivery, which is the second step, we diversify. We choose a unique path through the variants in time. And it's that pattern over time that when we find an illegal piece of content, we extract it, that we can then relate back to the individual user that was distributing the content illegally. Okay, so how does distributor watermarking typically look like for a content owner? So content owner, they distribute high quality mezzanine files, think J2K, ProRes, but also still XDCAM, HD50, so high bit rate, high quality content, UHD, but also HD. They have usually a mastering facility. They have their own internal content management system from which they then distribute the content to their various customers, the operators. Watermarking, the two-step watermarking is applied here as well. So there will be a step which creates the various variants, which will be stored. And then when someone delivers, requests a content, a piece of content, a movie, it gets individualized in the process. And that's usually in combination with fast file delivery platforms, think Aspera, Signiant, but could also be others. So that is then individualized at time of download. If content leaks, like I said, from their platform, the content owners will have a handle back to which operator it leaked from. And this is done usually in combination with an online piracy detection service. So that's the company that goes out, does all the crawling just like Google, and searches all the different places where you can find links to illegal content, all the way drilling down till it actually finds it, downloads it, and runs it through detection. Okay. If we move over to the OTT side, the streaming side, the consumer level watermarking, a lot of questions that everyone asks is, how do I integrate that into my system? And we see that there are still a great diversity of solutions out there. And typically, these are the three high-level solutions that we can offer for watermarking. There's watermarking that can be embedded inside an encoder. So the encoder basically, as output, produces not one stream, but produces a stream with the two variants. You can have a so-called post-encoder solution that is taking the output of an encoder, each of the different tiers in an adaptive bitrate stream, and is modifying the encoded content. So there are watermarks that work on the baseband, and some of the watermarks can work on actually encoded content. And doing the same, producing two outputs, or four, or whatever is the requirement. And finally, there could be a location where you integrate with a just-in-time packager where the post encode watermarking is done there. And each of them have different benefits, and that depends entirely of the workflow. So often, we as watermarking companies go sit with your architects and work out what's the best solution for you. Variant switching upon playout. So there's two ways. We see customers that are using a lot of different CDNs, and they're switching from one CDN from day to day. And they do not have full control over each of their CDNs. So there's a point where you can do that individualization at the edge of the network, at the edge of the CDN, the last step where you deliver to the customer. That's a very optimal location where you can do either modify the URLs coming in, so you have a generic URL says, give me segment 12, and then internally you can translate that to, okay, feed them segment 12A or segment 12B. That's a very simple integration at the edge, or you can even process the content as it's going through, and that depends on the capabilities of the watermark. If you do not have that that capability with each of your CDNs, or you do not want to be limited to a specific CDN in order to reach all of your customers, the alternative is to work with playlist generation. So you have to think of dynamic advertisement. They often also do playlist, unique playlist delivery, so they individualize the playlist. So watermarking can work in a similar way. So you deliver a playlist which says 1A, 2A, 3B, 4B, 5A, to a specific user, and another user will get another pattern through the playlist. This is high level. There's security layers in between to make it non-obvious, but this is where it comes down to. Benefits of the first is, yeah, you can work with any CDN. Benefits of the edge integrated one is fewer changes to your end-to-end workflow. I'd like to finish off before I go to the questions with saying that watermarking is part technology. So in order to have a full end-to-end protection of your content, it's your content protection, you think your DRM, your conditional access. First step is your distributor-level watermarking. Second step is your consumer-level watermarking, so you can really drill down where's the piracy, who's behind it, what can we do with it? Find the identity. You can switch it down, switch it off. If it's a live stream, you can immediately hammer on the pirates as they're rebroadcasting the content. But in order to do that, you also need to have piracy detection services. If you can't find the illegal content, you can't do anything about it. And you also don't have an idea how big your problem really is. Yeah? So that can impact your brand, that can impact your negotiations with the content owners, things like that. Apart from technological means, there's also all the legal options that you have. So think of site blocking. So there's countries and in the world where we can actually block IP ranges, etc. In the UK, for instance, there are laws in place that will not allow to block, for instance, the Pirate Bay or real-time block ISPs that do not that aid in distributing live streaming, for instance. There are site blocking tools that you can work with the specific ISP. So we as Editor, for instance, are integrated with YouTube to immediately take down streams if we find content there. With the identity, we can provide criminal prosecution as well. So if you decide to take the next step and go after a large pirate that is a repeat offender, and want to make an example of that, we, with watermarking, we can help collect the evidence and use it. And then you can go to the next step, the civil action, as I mentioned. So the two together give you a full 360 protection of your valuable content. And yeah, we believe that as watermarking companies, we can make that happen for you.
Excellent. We should take a question now, see if we have any questions before we go. Anyone have a good stumper for Eric?
Okay.
All right, we have one. Why is there still piracy? All right.
I'm very new to watermarking in general, so maybe this is an easy question, but are there technologies out there to counteract the watermarking that you put into this content? Is there ways to strip it out, or is that, once it's in there, it's in there?
Well, the whole purpose of watermarking is that we modify the content in such a way that you can't take the mark out, no matter if you do a camcording, no matter if you transcode, change the resolution, etc. So the answer would be no, but if you go really to, well, tiny little resolutions and you re-encode 1,000 times, yeah, the content is not watchable, but yeah, the watermark will be gone. So, but if you want to have a reasonable quality of content, watermark will survive. That's the purpose.
All right, round of applause for Eric. Great job,
Thank
Eric.
You.